Public Banking TV presents Money is Credit, Banking on the Future, based on Time for a New Theory of Money by Ellen Brown, adapted and narrated by Bob Bowes. Our financial system has routinely gotten into trouble with periodic waves of depression like the one we're battling now. In part, this is due to a flawed perception of the roles of banking and credit, and of the nature of money itself. In our economic adolescence, we've regarded money as a thing, something independent of the relationship it facilitates. But today, there is no gold or silver backing our money, and coins compose only about 1/10,000th of the broadest measure of the money supply, M3. All of the rest is created by banks when they make loans, and that includes Federal Reserve notes or dollar bills, which are created by the Federal Reserve, a privately owned banking corporation, and lent into the economy. Virtually all money today originates as credit, or debt, which is simply a legal agreement to pay in the future. Money is not a commodity or a thing, but is merely a relation, a legal agreement, a credit-debit arrangement, an acknowledgement of a debt owed and a promise to repay. The concept of money as a commodity can be traced back to the use of precious metal coins. Gold is widely claimed to be the oldest and most stable currency known, but this is not actually true. Money did not begin with gold coins and evolve into a sophisticated accounting system. It began as an accounting system and evolved into precious metal coins. Money as a unit of account, a tally of sums paid and owed, predated money as a store of value, a commodity or thing, by 2 millennia. And the Sumerian and Egyptian civilizations using these accounting entry payment systems lasted not just hundreds of years, as with some civilizations using gold, but thousands of years. Their bank-like ancient payment systems were public systems, operated by the government in the manner that courts, libraries, and post offices are operated as public services today. The Credit Revolution. The issue with precious metal coins was that their quantity could not expand to meet the needs of trade. This problem was solved by the medieval bankers who succeeded in creating a flexible money supply, one that could keep pace with a vigorously expanding mercantile trade. They did this through the use of credit, something they created by allowing overdrafts in the accounts of their depositors. Under what came to be called fractional reserve banking, the bankers would issue paper receipts called banknotes for more gold than they actually had. Their shipping clients would sail away with their wares and return with gold or silver, settling accounts and allowing the bankers' books to balance. The credit thus created was in high demand in the rapidly expanding economy, but because it was based on the presumption that money was a thing, gold, the bankers had to engage in a shell game that periodically got them into trouble. They were gambling that their customers would not all come for their gold at the same time, but when they miscalculated, or when people got suspicious for some reason, there would be a run on the banks, the financial system would collapse, and the economy would sink into depression. Today, paper money is no longer redeemable in gold, but money is still perceived as a thing that has to be there before credit can be advanced. Banks still engage in money creation by advancing bank credit, which becomes a deposit in the borrower's account, which becomes checkbook money. In order for their outgoing checks to clear, however, the banks have to borrow from a pool of money deposited by their customers, and if they don't have enough deposits, they have to borrow from the money markets or other banks. As British author Ann Pettifor observes, the banking system has failed in its primary purpose, to act as a machine for lending into the real economy. Instead, the banking system has been turned on its head and become a borrowing machine. The banks suck up cheap money and return it as more expensive money, if they return it at all. The banks control the money spigots and can deny credit to small players who wind up defaulting on their loans, allowing the big players with access to cheap credit to buy up the underlying assets very cheaply. The recent foreclosure frenzy is a perfect example of how credit contractions allow banks to obtain massive amounts of real estate for extremely depressed prices. The public credit solution. The flaws in the current scheme, including the 2008 bailout of the too-big-to-fail banks and the current mortgage scandals, are being exposed in the major media. The banking system may well be coming down. The question, then, is what to replace it with. What is the next logical phase in our economic evolutionary path? The place to start may be to recognize that A, credit needs to come first, and B, we as a community can create our own credit without having to engage in the sort of impossible pyramid scheme in which we're always borrowing from Peter to pay Paul at compound interest. We can avoid the pitfalls of privately issued credit with a public credit system, a system banking on the future productivity of its members, guaranteed not by things shuffled around furtively in a shell game vulnerable to exposure, but by the community itself. A public bank that generates credit in the national currency can be established by any size community or group, as long as it meets capital and reserve requirements and other stringent banking laws. The most feasible option is a state, since it can easily meet those requirements without jeopardizing the solvency of its collective owners. There is a precedent establishing that a state-owned bank can be both a very sound and very lucrative investment. The Bank of North Dakota, currently the nation's only state-owned bank, is rated AA and recently returned a 26% profit to the state. A decentralized movement is growing in the United States to explore and implement this option. For more information, see www.public-banking.com. We have struggled and evolved and emerged with new clarity. Money today is simply credit. When the credit is advanced by a bank, when that bank is owned by the community, and when the profits return to the community, the result can be a functional, efficient, and sustainable system of finance. Ellen Brown is an attorney and the author of 11 books. In Web of Debt, The Shocking Truth About Our Money System and How We Can Break Free, she shows how the Federal Reserve and the Money Trust have usurped the power to create money from the people themselves, and how we the people can get it back. Her websites are webofdebt.com, ellenbrown.com, and public-banking.com.